Bonjour à tous.
Donc je vais vous présenter déjà l'orateur, donc Christophe Ambroise. Je pense que vous le connaissez déjà pour un certain nombre d'entre vous. Donc il est professeur de statistique à l'université d'Évry et également directeur du laboratoire statistique et génome qui fait partie de la Génopole à Évry, hein, qu'on connaît tous, hein, qui est reconnu au niveau international. Alors Christophe travaille sur la classification. Alors, classification de graphes, d'accord, donc ce sont des objets très contemporains et à base de modèles probabilistes. Donc, vous devinez pourquoi je l'ai invité. Et il applique cela en génomique. Alors, juste un petit mot supplémentaire pour dire que pourquoi j'ai invité Christophe, tu te poses peut-être la question. Je trouve que tu as un très très bon, on va dire, très bonne répartition de ton travail. J'avais dit que je ne dirais pas grand-chose hier. Entre les aspects théoriques, parce que je trouve que c'est important quand on peut faire un peu de théorie, d'en faire, et quand on, parfois, enfin, ça permet de s'asseoir sur des bases solides, mais tu n'oublies jamais l'aspect calculatoire, c'est-à-dire que les algorithmes qu'il utilise est toujours disons conscient qu'il faut les appliquer, qu'il y a des problèmes de temps de calcul, etc. Alors par ailleurs, tu as le courage de te confronter à des vrais problèmes, d'accord, des problèmes sur des données réelles et qui sont d'envergure, parce que derrière ces problèmes de biologie qui ont des impacts sur notre société. Et puis enfin, je trouve que tu vas jusqu'au bout du chemin. Et j'incite à ça également avec les gens avec qui je travaille à Lille, de faire des logiciels, c'est-à-dire de diffuser les travaux aussi bien au sein de la communauté que vers les praticiens qui parfois ne connaissent pas très bien les méthodes, et ça leur permet de les utiliser. Donc pour moi, c'est quatre aspects de la statistique moderne sur lesquels tu as pu appuyer de manière notable sur les quatre aspects importants à mon avis. Voilà. Donc je tenais à le dire et merci d'avoir accepté mon invitation car je sais que tu es assez chargé.
Donc ben, merci pour l'invitation déjà et puis pour l'introduction dithyrambique, alors qui met une pression. Donc je vais vous parler effectivement de réseaux qui sont des objets qui sont devenus assez à la mode dans le milieu des statisticiens au début des années 2000 et puis qu'ils sont toujours. Alors c'est transparent et les travaux que je vais vous présenter doivent beaucoup aux réflexions menées dans un groupe de travail qui s'appelle Statistics for System Biology, qui regroupe des laboratoires de l'INRA, du département de mathématiques de l'INRA, et puis évidemment à tous mes collègues du laboratoire statistique et génome et d'autres laboratoires. Donc, en particulier donc, Julien Chiquet, Yves Grandvallée et Catherine Mathias. Voilà. Alors, donc, je vais vous parler de deux aspects principalement. Un, de l'info. Oui. Oh, you want me to switch? I'm sorry. I switch to English. So I will speak about two particular aspects of networks. So inferring networks and studying networks. And in studying, there is many possible study, and I will focus on clustering the nodes of a network. Okay, so first, starting with motivation, living systems are like Lego. So it's very simple. There are very simple basic building elements. So six, and four types of molecule in all living systems. So molecule for carrying energy, for storing energy, lipids. For storing information, nucleic acid, and for doing all the work. So for transporting information, for helping in all reaction. But what make the complexity of the living systems are the great number of interaction. So, and here we will focus on intracellular biological networks. So there are generally three types of networks we speak about. Gene interaction networks. So how the expression of genes has an impact on the expression of other genes. Protein networks, so physical interaction between these complex molecules. And metabolic networks, so all the links between the products of the chemical reaction within the cell. And in this talk, I will just speak about gene interaction network. So as you can see here, we have a network in a, I don't know which mammalian cells it is, maybe a part of the human gene interaction network. And you can see that it's highly structured. So, but so it's a nice picture. Each node represents a gene, and each link represents an interaction. So, but it's so interaction is complex to define and may have a lot of different forms. So, we will begin by speaking about inferring the structure because, as you can imagine, it's not given. So, what can we observe to derive such a network? And then, how can we deepen our understanding of the functioning of the system using this network? So first, basic. I'm sorry for. I know a lot of you are aware and of all this biological facts, but for those who are not, I spend a few seconds on the slide. So in all the cell of multicellular living system. You have a kernel containing all the genetic information. So here you have DNA. And what is wonderful is that in all my and your cell, you have the same genetic information, but all the cells have a different way of functioning and a different aspect, different. They are really different. So what makes the difference? For me, it's like here a program, and it starts in a way and goes its way, and it the program is different among tissue, it's different according to the development stages, or in response to environmental signals. And so the information is read, some RNA goes out of the kernel, and basically after this transcription there is a translation, even if things are more complex, and the RNA is transformed into proteins, and the proteins may go back to the kernel to influence the reading or go outside of the cell to transmit messages or participate to reaction or whatever. Okay. And so what kind of data can we observe? So we can observe many types of data, but in this talk, I focused on gene expression. So gene expression is the quantity of the messenger RNA that is in the cell. So for example, in a human cell, in a human organism, we have, let's say, about 20,000 to 25,000 genes. And so you can measure 25,000 gene expression in your cell. There are 25,000 genes which are expressed in the cell. And so there is a technology which allows to have a measure of the quantity in a given cell samples of each of these 25,000 genes. And so if you replicate the experiment, then you can fill a data table. Each line is an experiment. Each column is a gene. Okay? And most of the time, so as you are not so rich, so you have, let's say, 100 of the experiments and 20,000, or if you have many probes, many thousands of genes. And nowadays, maybe this technology will be abandoned for a better one. Nowadays, sequencing machine allows to... normally, sequencing machines are for sequencing the genome. So for a given human, have the whole sequence, so that's 3 billion of letters. But it can be used to read the messenger RNA, and if you have a reference, you can take your reads and try to see where they fit. And so for each part of the genome, try to see how many reads you have in each corresponding location. So this time, basically, you have 3 billion columns, but you summarize the information, going back to the number of genes. But this time, so it's really n bigger, smaller than p. So the problem that we tackle is the following one. So from this kind of experiment, we want to select a few genes, not consider all the genes because it's not possible, simply. So maybe it's good to say it because some biologists would like to have the whole picture with one set of experiment, but it's not possible. So select a few genes and then find the interaction between the genes. And so what does it mean, find the interaction? I will say a little bit more about it, but I'm not a specialist, so. If you have replicate of the same experiment condition, I will have an undirected graph, and if I have a time series, I will have directed edges, so directed graph. So how to infer gene regulation networks from gene expression data? So the statistician answer would be, so you have to estimate the dependence between the gene expression that you measure, and from the dependence, then you can have an idea about the regulation mechanism. But maybe it's a direct regulation, maybe an indirect, there may be a lot of meaning in this ages. But nevertheless, having the network give you an idea for going forward in exploring the biological hypothesis you have. Okay, so just to detail a little bit more, so let's say it's not the truth, but that you have a given exam which gives you your IQ, and you want to relate IQ to other variables, and obviously the bigger you are, so and the better IQ you have, it's related, okay? But if you take into account the age, you see that that's the correlation between age and weight is also big, and that conditionally to the age, these two variables are not dependent. That's why we do not consider correlation as a measure of dependence. It was the initial idea. In 2005, it was a basic measure that was used. But we focus on partial correlation, which are measuring conditional dependence. And we use most of the time quotient model, not because it's the truth, but because it's really convenient. So, okay. So now, if we go to what the observation means, for each experiment, you can consider that you have a Gaussian vector with p variable, which corresponds to the p genes. And what we want to do is to draw an H, or maybe not draw an H, if and only if there is a conditional dependency between variable I and variable j. So, and if we have a time series, then we can have a directed H, if and only if we have a conditional dependency between I at time t and j at time t minus 1. And what is nice, so I will forget about time series. We did it for static data and for time series, but it really is the same story twice. Okay, so here our Gaussian multivariate normal vector is centered and has a covariance matrix sigma. And so I will denote by a bold X the matrix of observation. And we are particularly interested in theta, which is the so-called concentration matrix, the inverse of the covariance matrix. Because from this, from its entries, you can compute the partial correlation, which is a direct measure in the Gaussian framework from the conditional dependence between I and J conditionally to all other genes. And so, more than focusing on the estimation, we want to focus on the testing. That is, we are really interested in knowing if theta ij is zero or different from zero. Okay? So there is no link if it's zero, and one h if it's different from zero. So that's a problem, estimating this part. And so, as there are many more variables than observation, it's difficult to, it's impossible to use a classical likelihood maximum estimate. And so either you are Bayesian and you use your favorite prior and do the job, or you can use penalized likelihood. So the penalty has mainly three goals. So first, it allows to have a well-posed problem. If your penalty is nice and your likelihood is also nice, a unique solution of your problem. And then it allows you to give some prior knowledge, pass through from prior knowledge in the problem. And if you have other additional data, you can use it also in the penalty. So a very popular penalty is the L1 norm, for example, because it induces sparsity. Okay, so the first approach, so it was in 2006. So it was the simplest one, and it's working quite well. The so-called neighborhood selection proposed by Meyerhausen and Bühlmann. So they simply consider the gen I, so the one column of the matrix, and try to predict this colon I with all the other columns, with all the other genes. And so what is nice in this very simple linear regression setting is that the coefficient of your regression is directly related to the concentration matrix. So if you find a zero for beta j, it means that you don't have an age between gene I and gene j. So the thing is, you solve your problem p times, the same problem p times, with sometimes some incoherence because you can predict a link between I and j and not a link between j and I. So you have to symmetrize. And you can formulate the problem as a general pseudo-likelihood maximization. So a few, 2 years later, Banerjee and Dapremont proposed to do it not with a pseudo-likelihood, but with a Gaussian likelihood penalized with the L1 norm, so the sum of all the absolute value of the entry of the concentration matrix. And so then Friedman, Tipchirani, Astin, Tipchirani took the criterion and used the lasso to solve it. And so they are famous for this graphical lasso, but it was a preprint from Dapremont and Banerjee initially. Okay. And we propose with Julien Chiquet and Catherine Mathias to use an adaptative penalty to try to find a structure in the network and use the structure to drive the penalty. Okay, but I won't detail this one. I will detail another one. So, one example of penalty. So, what we do in what we can do is try to play with different penalties. And for example, one type of data which is occurring is the same experiment replicate for comparison between natural state and the cell with drug one, natural state and the state, the cell with drug 2 and with drug 3. And if you want to estimate relation between the genes, then you can, if you are very rich, so do things in a nice way and infer one gene for each condition, for each comparison of condition. But as you have really few experiments, you never do that. So what people do, they merge all what they have, even if it has obviously not the same distribution, and they infer one network. And so what we propose to do is an in-between. So try to merge all the data to infer three different networks with a common part. And so how do you do that? So you have T samples, but not T samples, T experiment, and then in each you set a T set of experiments, and in each of your set of experiments you have a given distribution with a given matrix. Okay, and so if you ignore the relationship between all the tasks, you just have to sum the T problems and solve, well, it's the same than solving your problem separately, basically. But what you can do is try to, so here T is equal to 4, so I have 4 type of experiments, and I want to infer 4 networks. So what you can do is to say, if I see an age between X1 and gene 1 and gene 2 in condition in the set of experiment, the first set of experiments, then maybe it should be common in all the experiments. I encourage it to be present in all the set of experiments. And so if you formulate this problem, you can have a group lasso formulation to solve the problem. But what we did is the following. We added the assumption that if it's a positive correlation, sorry, or a negative correlation, it should stay positive or negative across all the set of experiments, so sine currents. So what is a little bit disappointing, as usual in biology, there are counter examples, and discussing with biologists, they find you example where it's not true. There is not always sine consistency, but most of the time it's true. So let's go back to the group lasso formulation. So you have the same first part of the criterion, and what you want is a penalty. So you penalized here the group are the AGs. One group is one AGs. And the element of the group are the AGs in the set of experiments. So across all your four experiments. So here it's the sum of over the number of AGs, the sum of the number of different set of experiments. And so doing this penalization encourage, if one goes to zero, then it's with you encourage all the other to go to zero. So this formulation is exactly under so a criterion that you want to minimize or let's say maximize with a penalty, and so it's equivalent to having this problem, so maximizing under a constraint. So you want basically to, if your problem is nice, maximize a convex function and respect the following constraint. And if you choose a constraint which is also convex, then your problem is convex. And the thing is that if the form of your constraint has a lot or has some of sharp edges, then you have chances that the maximum, so the solution of your problem, the maximum of your constraint criterion come on the border and hit one edges. And if one sharp edges of the constraint, and so doing so, set one of the parameter to zero. So here, beta one is set to zero. So just to give you so it's not so easy to go into this representation very quickly. So just to give you an hint about the interpretation. Here I have two tasks. So the task, two set of experiments, and two groups. So the groups is here. And so for example, for the first group, if I set the coefficient to zero and I set the coefficient to zero for the second group, then basically, I encourage all my coefficients to be zero, and I solve a lasso problem. If I do the contrary, so all my coefficients, so one coefficient of the first group, one coefficient of the second group are different from zero, then I solve a ridge regression problem. And so I will bias my estimate, but I don't force them towards zero. And so what we propose to do is, it was simple. So instead of doing a group lasso, we do a group lasso with sine consistency. So we separate the positive part of the vector from the negative part. And then doing so, we had some edges, some sharp edges to the constraint zone, and we encourage the sine consistency. Okay, In this field, there are many, many publications, and so most of the times there is one part with simulation and one small theoretical part, and so all the demonstrations are quite closed. And so we took the paper of back about the group lasso, and the demonstrations were quite similar, and we are able to prove the asymptotic. So when you n grows to infinity, then you recover the true support with probability 1. So you recover the structure of your networks with probability 1. But most of the times, you are not interested in the asymptotic because you have a small number of experiments. And so we also explored the some oracle inequalities for prediction and for estimation. And we have also a few hints about how it behaves practically. So that's only, practically it's not very useful, it's just reassuring. Okay, so what you can do when you tackle such problems is predicting the gene expression, and most of the time you don't care about it. Estimating the link between the gene expression, so the weight theta ij, and you don't care really. And what we were focusing on was testing if the link was present or not. So, and it's related to selection, or detecting of, or if there is any information in your data set allowing you to say, I can predict something or I cannot. So that's four different problems. And for the first three, there is a nice, but I have difficulties to read it, paper from Nicolas Verzelen, yeah, which is really interesting because it shows you that there are some sort of phase transition in the problem, and that, so K is the size of your support, P is the number of your gene, and N the number of your experiments. So for a given, when this quantity is small compared to N, everything is fine. When this quantity is too big, you, in terms of minimax risk, it grows exponentially, and you have no chance to have something reasonable. And in between, you don't know really. So that's what I understood from the paper. And it's very interesting because it just tells you that you cannot expect this kind of algorithm and strategies to work well for a really high dimension. So, okay. So a small example. So it was a PhD student of mine, Marine Jean Mougin, which was working on breast cancer. And they were considering 82 women with a very nasty type of breast cancer with a lot of relapse, ER minus tumors. And they wanted to see if there is a difference between the relation of the gene implied in the prediction of relapse or no relapse. So there are two groups of women, 31 with relapse and the other 51 with no relapse. And so we selected 62 genes. So you see, we had 20,000 genes, but here I have n equal to p, so almost of the order of p. And so you can expect the methodology to give something meaningful. And so we inferred two networks with the COP lasso, one that works for the relapse and one that works for the not relapse. And so you can see that they are very similar. So the behavior of the genes are very similar between the two set of women. But there are a few differences. So here, two ages are different. And what you would like to know, if are these differences significant? So there are not that many work on finding confidence intervals because bootstrapping doesn't do a nice, basic bootstrapping does not do a nice job for having confidence intervals, but it's an interesting field of research. But when you give this kind of result to biologists, he will focus on the study of this. So instead of being lost in the 62 genes, maybe he will pay more attention to the one which have different relation. Okay, so now I will switch the subject, and I will go to the partitioning of a random graph. So here I was lazy and I didn't change the notation I am used to. So Xij has a totally different meaning. So I'm sorry about that because so it's my random variable, but this time Xij is the age. So before it was theta, now it's Xij. So it could be real valued or binary or whatever. If you consider presence or absence of ages, so Xij equal to 1 or equal to 0, the simplest model, so yes, maybe I go back just to explain you the transition. The first step is to infer the graph. And once you have the graph, you want to see if it's it has some specific properties, if you can say something more. So most of the times, for example, a biologist would like to know if there are a group of genes which are related to a given function, and you want to test this kind of relation to a given biological function, etc. So if you consider an inferred graph, you have no ages or ages, and the most simple model is the Erdős-Sony model, which is basically the model with one parameter p, which is the probability of having an age between two nodes taken at random. But this kind of model is, this basic model is well studied, and most of the time when you speak about random graph, people think about Erdős-Sony. But it cannot model the so-called real network. So that was the trendy things a few years ago, real networks, because a lot of objects having relation can be represented as networks. So I have students working on web, so where the node of the networks are the website, and the link between the nodes are the hyperlinks, but you can have the same in biology, so the gene, metabolic network, etc. And amazingly, this kind of networks share common properties, so a common statistical distribution following a polar law, but most of the properties are due to the presence of hub, that is, nodes having really a lot of connection. There are a few hubs having a lot of connection in social networks, political personalities. They know everybody. They know a lot of... So, and the idea was to introduce heterogeneity in the model to render the structure of the network. So you heard a lot about this model during this SFDS week. So that's a stochastic block model. So it's a model where you assume there are Q groups, but you don't have access to these groups. They are hidden. So Zi is the color of the group. It's a set of latent variables. We spy the proportion of the group. And what you observe is the link between nodes, which is your random variable. And you assume that conditionally to the color of the group, conditionally to the latent variable, you have independence of the presence or absence of the ages. And the simplest model is to take, so presence or absence, so a Bernoulli law with parameter depending on the color of the two nodes. So here you have, as parameter of the model, the proportion of the group and the probability of having an age from yellow to green, from blue to yellow to green, and from blue to yellow. A few words. We have exactly the same model with continuous valued ages. It's not more complex, but I chose to present the presence absence model. So one very simple model, which has only a few parameters, is to consider that your distribution differs is defined by two parameters. One, when you have the same color between shared by node I and node J, or different colors. Okay, so basically, you have one parameter of connection defining the probability of connection within a group, and which is alpha, and one parameter defining the probability of connection between two groups, which is beta. And this very simple model allows you to model, for example, communities. Communities, they are strong alpha and small beta, or what is called dissertative mixing, which is a close to bipartite graph, so which is small alpha and high beta. Okay. Also, I forget about the weighted case. I'm sorry. And one theoretically interesting case is the case where all the groups are in equal proportion, which is it's one convenient hypothesis. So that's here the so-called adjacency matrix. So that's the matrix X with a black dot when X I J is equal to 1 and white when it's to 0. So the graphical representation is here. And so it was introduced a long time ago. So the first, amazingly, the first reference I found, it was not exactly the stochastic block model, but very close to it. It was from Govaert in the late 70s. And then there is a famous paper by Frank and Avery in the 80s, and some other papers followed, presenting slight modification of the model or optimization algorithm. And so there are extensions of the model. One is due to Pierre Latouche, which was presenting a session this week. And so it's overlapping stochastic block model, allowing one node to belong to many classes. Okay, so how to estimate the parameter of such a model? It's not so simple because there are dependencies everywhere. So it's not a simple mixture model. And you cannot compute the likelihood, analytically the likelihood of your model. So what you can do is rely, for example, on an EM algorithm and basically consider this kind of the expectation of this kind of joint probability. So that's the probability of the observed data joined to the latent variable, so the so-called complete log likelihood. And so you can use EM algorithm or Bayesian strategies for inferring the parameter. But then, in both cases, you have to compute the probability of the latent variable knowing the observed one. And this probability is impossible to write down. So most of the times, so people propose to approximate this probability using variational approaches and consider this probability as being a product of distribution, which is not true. But amazingly, it was there are a few works on the subject. All these methods, which are approximation, works very well on graph, and there are theoretical reasons. So the quality of the variational approximation is unknown, but there are asymptotics showing that in this particular case for networks, the stochastic block model with the variational approach is equivalent to the classical EM and find the true value and not only a lower bound for the likelihood. So that's a nice result from Alain Sellis, and there is also a following paper of Catherine Mathias and Mahendra Maria Dasu on the subject. So what we did, it was an idea of Catherine Mathias. We proposed an alternative method for estimating the parameter of this model. So it was just before these two papers. So the idea, so we have the latent variable, the observed one, we assume this, that's the basic assumption we have. We assume that second order moment exists, conditionally to the latent variable. And here, so it's not complex, we consider a set of index, a set of nodes. And here we denote by xi the subgraph created by this subset of nodes. And then we have a function g working of this subgraph. And we have the expectation of this function of a subgraph, and here the empirical estimation of this moment. So for example, the expectation of the presence of an edge, so that the probability of having an edge between two nodes, that's M1, or here, that's what we use, the probability of having a given configuration between three nodes. So the probability of having a triangle, a V, or nothing. So the log probability. So we use these two moments, statistics, in order to estimate the parameter of the model. And so we have a nice theorem stating that, so maybe it seems very simple because we just say that the empirical moments are converging toward their true value. But as there are a lot of dependencies everywhere, it's not so simple to show. And then, moreover, we have the asymptotic normal distribution with two cases, equal group proportion and different group proportion. And so we show that this empirical moment are asymptotically normal with a rate of convergence of 1 over the square root of n, or 1 over n. And from this, we build two strategies, so either estimating the parameter using moment estimator, or either estimating composite likelihood estimator, or pseudo-likelihood. So just to give you an idea, because the time is running out, maybe I will skip the experimental part. So I just want to give you an idea of how it works. Here, I simulated a network. And then in the network, I counted the number of full triangles, the numbers of V of this type. There are three types of V because the order of the node is given. And the number of triplets with one connection, and the number of triplets without connection. So that's basically a summary of the graph. And from this summary, I have a model. So I say that each line of this data table is the realization of a mixture of Bernoulli multivariate distribution with constraint between the parameter, and we estimate the parameter of this mixture. So it's a Bernoulli mixture with four or five components according the number of hidden groups. If there are more than two hidden groups, then you go to five components. Less than two hidden groups, you have four components. And so, estimating the parameter of this mixture, I get alpha and beta. And so it's a simple EM algorithm, which gives me the estimation of my parameter. And even if we have exactly like for Dave this morning, David this morning, even if we are not in the exact condition of the theorem of Allman, Matthias, and Rhodes, it showed that there are chances that the parameter of the that the model is identifiable. Okay, so I will skip this. I will skip this part just to. Yeah, I'm sorry. Once you have the parameter, you have to estimate the latent variable. Because most of the times, people are not interested in estimating the parameter. They don't care about the parameter of the network. What they are interested in is estimating who belongs to which node belongs to which group. And so we propose to do it using the complete likelihood, so the joint distribution of the observed and latent variable. It gives us a criterion that we have the parameter, and the only unknown part are the latent variables. So we optimized this criterion according to Z in order to find the groups. So let's say it's a kind of EM algorithm with one step for estimating the parameter and one step for estimating the latent variable. Okay, so I did a numerical experiment, which I just give you the conclusion. The conclusion is a little bit disappointing, but it was fun to do it. It's using the variational approach or the two proposed approach. I just described this approach. So using the variational approach is as efficient as using our proposition. But it's specific to this network problem. So, and to conclude, so we have to really be aware of the limitation of this kind of model. So the first for the inference, it's very unstable. So you have to be very careful using this kind of model. For doing community detection or finding structure on a graph, the stochastic block model is very powerful. Stochastic block model and extension. I didn't spoke about detecting local structure on the graph, but it's a very interesting topic also. And we developed R package. So, but this, so Simon and Mixer are temporarily out of the cron because they don't say when they archive the package. So in a few days, you can download them, but in a few days they will be officially again on the cron. And this one, Quadripen, is a nice one for doing sparse regression. Okay, thank you.
Merci beaucoup. Donc il nous reste 5 minutes pour des questions. Je pense qu'on peut en faire 2 ou 3 si elles sont courtes.
I think it's a general question, but you mentioned that in the second part of your talk that those networks, I think we know that in general they have a specific structure. And you said that they're organized around the hubs, and that's something. I mean, we found clearly, like when you look at the protein-protein interaction network. But in the first part of your talk, I mean that's something we didn't really see in your results, and I wanted to know if actually you could use more prior information or try to drive your algorithm such that
yes.
I mean it could find those hub genes or hub proteins and then look at the interaction.
We did that with Camille Charbonnier and Julien Chiquet. So we tried to have an algorithm for sparse regression, so for inferring the structure of the network, detecting hubs, and allowing them to have even more connection. So using this kind of prior, and it's true that it's improving the, at least using simulation, it's improving the quality of the reconstruction. That's a nice idea.
Une autre question?
Yeah, the question is a bit connected maybe to the first question is because it seems like a contradiction. This you have the hub structures that many people believe in, and then you have the graphical issue that has basically only one lambda, so it penalizes everything in the same way. And in neighborhood selection, one advantage of that is in principle very easy to use different lambdas across regressions. What is your comment to that?
I'm sorry, I really...
Like if you would use neighborhood selection,
yeah,
where you have all your P regressions, it's conceptually very easy to use different lambdas. And yeah, that basically appeals to the hub structures, right? Because in hubs, yeah. Is there a way in graphical ASU that you can accommodate different local sparsity, so to say? So different lambdas.
So if you are using neighborhood selection, is not prone to mix with. It's not so easy to mix with the prior on the structure because you are solving your problem almost independently.
That is if you have a strong prior about the structure, but if you believe if you don't use priors, but you just believe that. Some nodes have a lot of connections and some have very few.
Yes.
It's kind of strange to use one lambda value in your graphical ASU because you penalize everything. Lambda represents the number of connections.
Yes. So it's possible. And there are a few papers on the subject in the biological field. You mean, for example, using external knowledge, telling you that this connection is highly probable or...
they're more like that you can adapt to different sparsity across the network, so that you don't need, because one lambda basically means the sparsity is the same across the network.
Yes. So that, as I said, it was not our work, but I think a paper of Lindberger tried to do this kind of thing. So, yeah, because you want to adapt according the nodes and the knowledge you have. Yeah.
Alors, je vais peut-être poser juste une dernière question pour conclure. Dans tes triangles, tu as besoin de calculer tous tes triplets
Alors non, en fait... Pardon.
En français ou en anglais, en fait, les questions. Au départ, je t'avais dit qu'on allait...
Oui.
Comme tu veux.
En français... Non, en fait, c'est un modèle qui s'échantillonne donc sur des très gros graphes. Au début, en fait, on le faisait... L'idée de base, c'était de prendre que des triangles qui étaient indépendants. Et puis après, on s'est aperçu que... Parce que donc Catherine m'avait dit il faut absolument que tout soit indépendant. Et puis après, on s'est aperçu que, en fait, la théorie et la pratique, ça marchait en prenant tout aussi. Mais pour répondre à ta question, donc, c'est un modèle qui s'échantillonne en gardant ses propriétés. Donc on n'est pas obligé de prendre tous les triangles, on peut en tirer au hasard. Qu'ils soient indépendants ou pas.
D'accord. Ben merci Christophe. Exposé assez dense.